Today, lost in the heat and smoke, a firefighter makes a deadly decision.
I figured I'm going to take my mask off and take the deepest breath of the superheated smoke that I can and burn everything as fast as I can through my lungs. I just wanted to die quickly.
In the midst of the fire, he heard a voice.
When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned.
See how an angel came to his rescue. That's next on Canadian Edition. Well, hello and welcome to Canadian Edition. I'm David Gartz, and thank you for joining us on today's program. We're just a couple of more weeks. We're going to come to Pentecost Sunday. That's on June 12th this year. And in churches, particularly the United Church and the Church of England and some of the more the Presbyterian churches, the Anglican expressions of the faith where the church calendar is celebrated, the day of Pentecost is that day when we celebrate the fact that Jesus fulfilled a promise. Here between Easter and the Feast of Pentecost, the Day of Pentecost, we've been talking about the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus said in his teaching in Luke 24, verse 49, he said to the disciples, "Tarry in Jerusalem until you're given the power and presence of the Holy Spirit." And we've been doing just a little teaching up front of each of our programs during this season to help you understand what it means to have the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. When we have the Holy Spirit, according to Paul in Galatians 5, 22, he says we have love, we have joy, and we have peace. Peace is what we want to talk about today. No matter what circumstance we find ourselves in, we have a peace, the Bible says, that passes understanding. It just doesn't make any sense. Christians have the ability, in the worst of circumstances, to be at peace because they know who holds tomorrow. Jesus does. But they also know who holds them in the palm of his hand. The Bible says that we're carved on the palm of his hand. And we can be at peace knowing that we're secure. Are you at peace today? If you're not, we want you to know that the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, is the ultimate answer to what you're seeking. Knowing him and experiencing him will bring a peace which passes understanding. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. Across this great nation, we have lines that are available, and they connect to people who know the power of Jesus Christ in the Holy Spirit and also have the peace of that presence. If you need peace this day, peace with God, peace within yourself, peace with that which is happening around you, please call us, 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. While Fernando Vulcana was an experienced firefighter, he was also a world-class bodybuilder. Eventually, he became so confident in his abilities that he felt invincible until he took a risk that required a supernatural rescue.
The worst thing that could happen to a firefighter happened to me. In all the smoke and the heat, I got lost. I could not find my way out of that hallway.
After a bad decision when responding to a routine fire call, Fernando Vulcana was now at the brink of death. His dream of saving lives had now become his worst nightmare. His passion to fight fires started when he was just a boy.
I was always intrigued, like most kids are, with the fire department, police department. But it wasn't until a house burned down next door to me when I was about 9 years old and I saw all those guys in action from across the street. That's when I figured, boy, I'm going to be a firefighter.
Fernando became a firefighter. He also married Elizabeth and started a family.
I really felt the Lord put us together. I felt secure and safe, and I felt that he was going to take care of me.
She was very kind, and she loved the Lord. That was the common bond that we had, really. We both wanted to serve the Lord.
Fernando loved the challenge of being a firefighter.
You just get used to helping and understanding that whatever's broken, you're going to try and fix it. You almost look at things mechanically. You can't take it too personal.
Life was good for the young family, but Fernando started a hobby that drew his attention away from his family and God.
I had good genetics for bodybuilding, so I got deeper and deeper into it. And I wasn't thinking of getting competitive until a couple of years into it. I competed for 3.5 years, and I did very well as an amateur, as a matter of fact, and I won the Ironman competition.
Bodybuilding became an obsession.
All of the different things that I promised my wife I wouldn't get involved in, I did get involved in. like being competitive and wearing little shorts up on stage, steroid use, which was necessary at my level of competition.
Instead of talking about God, now he was talking about himself and how he needed to build himself, and it was all about him. That's when my heart just sunk. I go, I'm losing my husband.
Fernando saw no need to change his course, and eventually Elizabeth had enough.
My wife told me, and I couldn't believe she told me this, I'm not sure if I love you anymore.
It wasn't like, you know, I wanted to walk away and you know, I wanted a divorce or anything like that. It was more like, it's just not working.
She continued to pray for her husband. But on the day Fernando's company was called to a routine office fire, everything changed. His captain sent them to knock out a wall in the burning building.
Because of my ego, my pride, my time on the job and experience, my bodybuilding, all these things, I figured, well, I'm just going to go in here and I know these guys will be right behind me. And I went up on that floor alone, which you never do.
After he knocked the wall down, he heard a frightening sound.
My bell began to ring on my regulator, and that gives a firefighter an indication that you've only got 2 to 3 minutes of air left and you got to find your way out. In all the smoke and the heat, I got lost. I could not find my way out of that hallway. I really felt stupid that I put myself in a situation like that knowing better. I thought instantly about my family, and I'm going to leave my wife home with these kids with no dad. I mean, the reality just hit all at once.
Then Fernando heard a voice.
The voice said, "Fear not, for I'm with you. I've called you by your name, you're mine. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you, for I am the Lord your God."
With his oxygen gone and blinded by the smoke, Fernando thought his time was up.
I figured I'm going to take my mask off and take the deepest breath of the superheated smoke that I can and burn everything as fast as I can through my lungs. I just wanted to die quickly. As I grabbed my mask, someone grabbed my armpit from my armpit and raised me up on my feet. And as I breathed in and opened my eyes, my head was sticking out of a fire escape window.
He made it down the escape and got medical attention. Then he asked his team who had pulled him out of the fire.
No one admitted to being up there. As a matter of fact, my captain said, "You should not have been there up there by yourself." And the Lord spoke to me a second time. And he said these words to me. He said, "The angel of the Lord encamps round about those that love him and fear him." And I knew that at that point that God himself rescued me, that there was an angel in that fire somehow that brought me to that window, or I would have been dead for sure. And that's when I decided that I was going to stop running from God and rededicate my life totally to Jesus Christ.
When my husband dropped that badge on the table and says that he was going to surrender, God gave me this job, and I'm giving it back to him.
Fernando quit bodybuilding. He also changed jobs with the fire department. Today, he's their chaplain. His and Elizabeth's marriage has never been the same.
He started focusing again on the kids, and his heart was getting warm again, and he's gentle and loving like he is today. And I was like, man, I got my husband back.
I remember David saying, "Even if I make my bed in hell," that's basically what I did. I had turned my back on God, no doubt about it. But he never, never forsook me. He brought me up. And that's faithfulness. He gave me another shot at life.
What a great story of God's intervention in someone's life at a point of incredible crisis. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5 says this, talking about the coming Messiah, prophesying about Jesus. "The chastisement for our peace was laid upon him." The fact that Jesus Christ came and was willing to go through all of the hell, may I use that expression that directly, because that's exactly what it was, all of the hell that he bore as he was crucified, beaten, and then rose again from the dead, really is an assurance for us that because he went through the worst that humanity has to offer, he knows our path. The Bible says that if we walk through the fire, it won't kindle upon us. We won't be ignited. And the reason we can do that is because Jesus himself walks beside us. I love the story of the children in the Old Testament, the three Hebrew children, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were thrown into a fiery furnace. And the Bible says that when the king looked in there, he saw the three walking around and a fourth like unto the Son of Man, another prophetic reference to the person of Jesus. What kind of fire are you in today? The promise is that he has been through that fire ahead of you, The chastisement for your peace was laid upon him. And now he's extending his nail-scarred hand, saying, take my hand. I'll walk with you through this. Do not fear. Fear not, for I am with you. Do you understand that relationship with him this day? Have you experienced him? Have you asked him to forgive you of your sins? Do you know that you're walking with him? If you do, no matter what fire comes, it will not kindle upon you, the Bible says. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of that furnace, it was a brand new day. We believe it will be a brand new day for you as you take Jesus' hand. Call us at those numbers on your screen, 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700, and we'll send you out some wonderful teaching material that will really encourage you. Because Jesus lives, and because he makes intercession for you, and because he's walked through the fire ahead of you, you can have the peace and the assurance that he will never leave you or forsake you. Give us a call and know the peace of Christ, which passes understanding. Well, still ahead, recording artist Michael W. Smith talks about the perils of fame.
If there's anything that I'm proud of in a good way, I'm thankful for, I may say that, is that I've survived success.
Our exclusive interview with Smitty is next. Well, throughout his 25-year career, Michael W. Smith has won dozens of awards and has performed in hundreds of concerts in front of thousands of people. But as he told Scott Ross, recently he noticed something was missing.
Michael W. Smith has won 3 Grammys and even been named one of People magazine's most beautiful people. Year after year, his artistic expressions find greater heights. In 2009, Smitty, as he is called by his friends, was inducted in the Gospel Music Hall of Fame. But everyone agrees that Smitty has stayed humble.
If there's anything that I'm proud of in a good way, or thankful for, I may say that, is that I've survived success.
How have you been able to keep that perspective? A good wife.
A good wife. Great friends.
Yeah.
I think more today than ever I know who I really am. Man saved by grace, everything's a gift. And how dare I think, check me out, I'm the guy, you know.
Yeah.
It's simply not true. You know, I love playing for people, and I love to see what it does to people, even in my living room, or even at New River Fellowship, where I go to church and lead worship, you know. And when I think about being blessed, I don't think about my house. I don't think about the car I drive. I think about my kids. I think about my wife.
Michael and Debbie's 29-year marriage began with love at first sight.
You know, I've never been more in love than I am today with Deb. We're doing really, really well. I think it's been extraordinary, the mercy and the goodness of God, of what I do, and I travel, and I'm in Indonesia, or I'm in Romania, and I come back, and I sort of can come back and, oh, how's it going? Let me fix you breakfast, you know what I'm saying?
What tore at Smitty's heart was recognizing the growing trend of despair he was seeing around him, even among Christians who came to his concerts.
Start to find out that a lot of those people did not have what I had. When I say that, I'm talking about my parents. Great mom and dad, who still to this day are my biggest fans, just have blessed me and just encouraged me and edified me to no end. You got a lot of people who walk with me and support me who never had that. So there's a lot of despair. There's a lot of heads down, just can't seem to get out of the gutter. So I decided that I would just pray a blessing over them at the end of this concert.
You stood up in a concert or after a concert and started verbalizing that, proclaiming blessing to
people? I did that, and you could hear a pin drop. I mean, it was powerful. I felt like even when I was proclaiming it over them, blessing them, that there was something supernatural going on. In the name of Jesus Christ, I bless you with all the promises of God, which are yes and amen. May God bless your ears to hear the lovely, the uplifting, and the encouraging. I remember walking off the stage going, wow, that was amazing, because you could just sense something was happening.
From that experience came the idea for Smitty's 12th book. It's called A Simple Blessing, The Extraordinary Power of an Ordinary Prayer. In it, he writes about speaking words of blessing and encouragement over others.
If you bless someone, they in turn should turn and bless someone else.
Yes.
And it becomes a reproductive process.
Absolutely.
Have you seen that?
Absolutely. Scott, the greatest joy of my life, really, is pouring my life into people and blessing people. The happiest people I know in the world are people who just bless people. You know, you're blessed to be a blessing to others. That's really the bottom line. That's the bottom line of the whole book.
In my work in ministry, I've had the privilege of interacting with and working with a variety of very successful people, both who are Christians and who are non-Christians. And one of the things that I find most interesting is that people who are successful often are very troubled people. They're not at peace within themselves. They know there's something out of alignment. And one of the things that we want you to understand is that God wants you to be successful, and He will equip you to do all you can do within your realm of ability and in your realms of capability. But the key is to understand where the success ultimately comes from. It doesn't come from you. It comes through you because of the grace and mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Philippians chapter 2, there's a wonderful description about Jesus, and it says that He humbled Himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. If you're relatively successful today and you're not at peace, or if you're totally unsuccessful and not at peace, we want you to know that the answer to that peace is not in you or from you, but it's because of Jesus Christ, who desires to live His humility in you by the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so, do you know the peace of Christ in your own heart? Are you at war with yourself? If you are, then humbly come to Jesus and confess that you've been captain of your own life much too long, that you haven't acknowledged that He is the source of your strength and your success, and then ask Him to forgive you. And when you do that, an interesting thing will happen. By the presence of the Holy Spirit, there'll be a peace. You'll be empowered then to live with this understanding that because you trust in Jesus, the sky's the limit. There are no limitations placed upon you, that anything is possible. The Bible says, behold, I can do all things, how? Through Christ who strengthens me. If you'll call us at 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700, we have a little teaching booklet we'd love to share with you called The Sky's the Limit. And the reason the sky's the limit is because we understand that we must live first at peace with Jesus Christ. And so if you would like to know the power of the Prince of Peace and be liberated for all that He has for you, call us at 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700. Please stay with us. We'll be back with more on Canadian Edition right after this break. Well, right now we're going to bring you a story you won't see anywhere else from a place where temperatures often fall to, listen to this, 60 below zero, and winter seems to last all year. That's what life is like in northern Siberia. But one man there is braving those frigid temperatures to share the gospel with remote tribes. Reporter George Thomas traveled to the far reaches of the Arctic Circle to meet him.
Thank you. Locals call this place Yamal.
Yamal means the end of the world.
And in many ways, it is.
There are no roads here. People use frozen lakes and rivers to get around on reindeer or snowmobile.
Latitude 70 degrees north. Longitude 70 degrees east. The Yamal Peninsula sits in the deep, frozen Siberian tundra above the Arctic Circle. The temperature here fluctuates between minus 30 and minus 60 degrees Fahrenheit.
Never worn so many clothes like this in my life. But we're almost ready.
It's a little after 6 a.m. Peter Hudi, our Siberian guide, does last-minute checks. The sleigh is attached to a snowmobile.
I have to make sure we have enough rope and other emergency supplies in case we get stuck.
Is this dangerous?
It's опасно.
Опасно, да.
Yes, it is.
Our destination this morning, a four-hour journey deep into the wilderness to meet a nomadic family. 2 hours into our journey, we stop for a brief moment.
It's about 9:25 in the morning. 9:25 in the morning, and the sun has yet to rise. And we're hoping to catch that before it rises. Let's go.
The sun here shines only for a few hours during the winter. When it does appear, normally around noon, the sunrise, well, it's something to behold.
This is a special place.
Peter belongs to the largest nomadic tribe called the Nyenyets. He's more than just a guide. You see, he's a Christian. And for the last few years, he's been sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with his tribe and others who live here in the tundra.
When I became a Christian, God gave me a new heart. He also gave me a new heart for my people. I go out on my snowmobile meeting these nomadic families and telling them about the love of Christ.
The Nyenyets are nomadic reindeer herders. The word Nyenyet means child of a deer.
This is, in essence, the lifeblood for the Nyenyets people here on the Siberian tundra, because their meat as well as their skin fetch a lot of money in the villages.
Our food, clothes, shoes, homes, our transportation, everything comes from them. Without reindeer, we cannot survive.
And learning how to survive in the tundra begins at an early age.
All my children were taught from a young age how to live in the harsh conditions. It is our way of life, but if you are not careful, you can die out here.
The women take care of cooking, sewing clothes, and putting up the teepees. The men are hunters and care for the reindeer. Peter is among a handful of evangelists reaching the Nyenyets people. He's been visiting Ustinia's family for a few weeks now.
He comes here to tell us about God. We have good conversations.
He says it all begins with friendship evangelism.
I brought presents for all the children today. Each box is filled with toys, school supplies, and a children's Bible. We have to build relationships first.
Modern technology, such as the snowmobile, cell phone, and generator, have certainly made life a little easier on the tundra.
Before, I had to rely on reindeer to get around. Now the snowmobile allows me to travel farther distances to meet families.
There are no verifiable numbers, but Peter estimates some 500 Nyenyets people have accepted the Lord in recent years.
There are still thousands more who have yet to hear about Jesus.
So for now, he continues to traverse the harsh landscape of the Siberian tundra in search of more people to share the good news of faith in Jesus. George Thomas, CBN News, in the Yamal Peninsula, northern Siberia.
Well, our President George Woodward joins us now. George, you've been up north with our First Nations people, but have you ever been in 60 below zero weather?
I have not been in 60 below. 40 is probably the worst or best, however you want to look at it. But 60 below, wow. How cold is that?
You know, the Bible says that the gospel is to go to the ends of the earth. And what we just saw was literally taking it to the ends of the earth in northern Siberia. But the Canadian 700 Club is doing that as well.
Exactly. You know, if you think about Siberia in Canada, we meet up there at the North
That's
Pole.
That's right,
so
we do.
We have the same kind of environment that you've just seen on that piece. And so we recognize that God loves every single person, whether they're in the heart of downtown Toronto or Vancouver, or whether the furthest stretches, farthest reaches of our country.
It's an amazing thing that the peace of Christ would actually be welcomed in those kinds of settings. We often think in those native settings in particular, those First Nation settings, that there's a lot of animism, that there would not be necessarily a lot of openness to the gospel. But we found an amazing openness to our ministries.
It really is. And, you know, people are people. And these folks, they have a yearning to really have a relationship with God. Maybe they don't have it well defined. They don't have all the religious upbringing that some of us might have had. But they have a yearning for God. And when they see the reality, when they see the truth, they embrace it. It's a wonderful thing.
Now, what is it that we're specifically doing with our First Nations people through the Canadian 700 Club?
Well, both with First Nations and with Inuit, what we've been doing is there's some communities that honestly, David, they look like third world communities when you go there. It's very surprising right here in our own country that that could be the case. So we've been sending them food, we've been sending them clothing, and we've been going there ourselves and declaring the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. We've watched people see, we've seen them have their physical needs met, but also at the same time, their life transformed through the gospel. So we've gone, give them food first, and then say, God loves you and wants to transform your life.
Now, people who are members of our Canadian 700 Club Ministries, our partners, what's the monthly membership? What do people, if they want to contribute to this, is it, how much a month do our partners get?
You know, as little as $20 a month.
Wow.
If you're not a partner now, you can be for as little as $20 a month. I was just thinking, that's sort of a half of a medium-sized Tim Hortons every day. That's about what it is.
Half of a medium-sized Tim Hortons. Okay, that's
good. But we can touch the nation when we all connect together and say we'll stand together as one. So as little as $20 a month, membership and part of what God is doing through the 700 Club here in Canada.
I guess what we're saying to you, ladies and gentlemen, is that man does not live by donuts alone. We can need to understand what an opportunity we have throughout Canada. And when you support George and the staff at our Canadian 700 Club Ministries, you're touching and changing people's lives. Mm-hmm. And if you would like to be a member of the 700 Club, just $20 a month can transform lives. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. And we want to encourage you. George and his prayer team are praying every day for our nation. We believe God has a plan for Canada.
That's right.
He desires to reach our nation from coast to coast and from border to border, so to speak, all the way up to wherever we touch Siberia. God wants to work among our Canadian people. And when you support us with your prayers and your finances, you're helping make that possible. And we want you to pray for Canada. When you call, we'll send you a little booklet on how to do that. But remember this, the peace of Christ will go coast to coast and border to border as we reach out in the name of Jesus. God bless you. We'll see you next time on Canadian Edition.
For more information, or if you'd like to help continue the ministry of Canadian Edition, please write to us with your gift today. Our address is CBA, Post Office Box 700, Scarborough, Ontario, M1S 4T4. Become a 700 Club partner and write today.